nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Oat?
Here.
Mr. Beistel? Mr. Calero?
Here.
Mr. Frye?
Here.
Mrs. Love?
Here.
Mr. Polakowski?
Here.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Here.
Mrs. Shipley?
Here.
Mr. Bentz?
Here.
Samantha Gray?
Here.
Hudson Nicholson?
Let the record show that Hudson is not here because he's at a soccer game this evening. He's one of our soccer players. And Samantha, I'd like to welcome you to your tenure on the board as a student representative. Feel free, as we're discussing things, if you have some input from the student perspective. Although you don't get a vote, you're always welcome to provide whatever input you would like. So welcome aboard. Happy to have you.
Citizens' comments?
We have no comment cards this evening, sir.
Thank you. Discussion minutes?
It's recommended that the board approve the minutes of the August 13, 2015 discussion session and the August 20th, 2015 board meeting, voting meeting.
Need a motion, please?
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Shipley, second.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Rhodes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes 9-0. Business and finance fund accounts?
It is recommended that the board approve the August 2015 board summary, fund accounting check summary, and treasurer's report.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Calero, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Frye. Questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0. Old business, seeing none. New business, advertised for bids.
It's recommended that the board authorize the Westmoreland Intermediate Unit Joint Purchasing Consortium to advertise for bids for multi-purpose paper, unleaded gasoline, and diesel fuel.
Need a motion, please?
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Rhodes, second by Mr. Beistel. Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0. WIU Joint Purchasing Consortium.
It's recommended that the board appoint James Marnell to represent the district at the Westmoreland Intermediate Unit Joint Purchasing Consortium and Lee Miswa as the alternate.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mrs. Love, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Polakowski. Questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0. Cedar Crest College?
It is recommended that the board approve an agreement between Cedar Crest College and the Southmoreland School District to permit Cedar Crest's nursing interns to complete field experience at Southmoreland.
Need a motion, please?
Second.
Is that Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Motion by Mrs. Shipley, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Polakowski. Question? Roll call, please.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0. Northwestern Human Services?
It is recommended that the board approve a contract between the Southmoreland School District and Northwestern Human Services for the provision of special education services for the 2015-16 school year at a cost of $133.92 per day per student.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Calero, second.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Shipley. Questions? Roll call, please.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0. Need a motion to recess.
Yes, for personnel.
David?
Mine will be public.
Okay. Motion for personnel only. Motion by Mrs. Rhodes, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Calero. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Second by Mrs. Rhodes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Personnel, autistic support aide.
It's recommended that the board approve the employment of Amanda Springer as an autistic support aide to accompany and support students as they participate in mainstream classes at Southmoreland Elementary School.
Need a motion, please? Motion by Mr. Fry, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Calero, questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr.
Holt?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. Head middle school girls soccer coach.
Thank you very much for that position, by the way. That will be a tremendous help to the program. It's recommended that the board approve Erin Askin as the head middle school girls soccer coach at a supplemental salary of $2,746 for the 2015-16 school year.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mrs. Shipley, second by Mrs. Love. Questions? Roll call.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Alt?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. Assistant middle school girls soccer coach.
It is recommended that the board approve Dan Boring as the assistant middle school girls soccer coach at a supplemental salary of $2,406 for the 2015-2016 school year.
Need a motion, please?
So
moved. Motion by Mr. Beistel, second.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Rhodes, questions? Roll call, please.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Alt?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. Resignation of middle school boys basketball coach.
It's recommended that the board accept the resignation of Dan Boring from his supplemental position of middle school boys basketball coach and authorize administration to post and advertise the position.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Beistel, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Polakowski, questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Alt?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. Temporary psychological services.
It is recommended that the board grant permission for the administration to enter into an agreement with Julie Van Skoy to provide psychological services to the district on a temporary per diem basis at the rate of $400 until Dr. Snyder is able to join us.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Calero, second by Mr. Fry. Questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Beistel? Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Alt?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. Senior National Honor Society sponsor.
It is recommended that the board approve Zach Cavalier as Senior National Honor Society sponsor at the non-athletic supplemental salary of $1,000 for the 2015-16 school year.
Need a motion, please? Motion by Mr. Beistel, second.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Rhodes, questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Alt?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. FMLA.
It is recommended that the board approve an intermittent family medical leave act leave for Sonia McNally for up to 12 weeks beginning on August 31st, 2015. This would be retroactive, please.
Need a motion, please?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Polakowski, second by Mrs. Love. Questions? Roll call, please.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Alt?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Benz?
Yes, motion passes 9-0. Student reports?
You're on, Samantha.
You're up, Samantha.
Pardon me?
Just
whatever material.
Just read your report that you have. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Open house will be held September 16th from 5:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. Friday, October 23rd is the homecoming game with Washington at 7 p.m. Friday, October 30th is the senior recognition night against Mount Pleasant at 7 p.m.
Thank you. So, October 30th, did you say?
Yes.
Thank you.
CWCTC report?
Thank you, Samantha.
Our September meeting is next week, so I have no report this evening.
Thank you. WIU report?
We made general operating decisions, but we did recall five classroom assistants back from the group that we had to furlough there. So I believe there's only one left that needs recalled, and we've put all of them back to classroom somewhere. That's all I have.
Thank you.
PSBA liaison report?
Nathan Maines, who is the executive director of PSBA, wrote an article talking about how the state budget's impasse puts politics above the needs of students. Despite weeks of negotiations, the budget is going on 3 months late. A major concern for school districts who have to cover operating costs without knowing what funding will be received. As the impasse continues, school districts' expenses continue to rise for pensions, health care, and utilities. All of these costs are out of districts' control. Total employer pension contributions for 2015-16 equal 25.84% of schools' expenses. These numbers will increase to 32.2% by 2019-20. Our school districts work hard to be fiscally responsible, but some districts will need to consider taking out loans to cover expenses. Although the budget decision lies with the state officials, it's really the students who will feel the pinch. Programs may have to be cut, class size may have to be increased with students getting less teacher attention. Mr. Maine says, quote, "Let's keep our priorities straight. Don't put politics before the needs of our children. A child only gets one chance to experience a particular year. We expect the best from our students, so they should receive the best a school district can offer. Providing a superior education for our children results in a stronger workforce and a stronger Pennsylvania," end quote. And as a side note here, I was able to peruse the Independent Observer, it's the current one, and the Fall Festival article was in there, and the theme for this year's Fall Festival is educating our future Southmoreland as a way to recognize the achievements of the Southmoreland School District in recent years. Mr. Siegel, who is the chairman of the is the program chairman of the Scottsdale Fall Festival Committee, is currently ranked, says that the district is ranked with the Pittsburgh Business Times as most overachieving district in the region. And he continues to list the other achievements that our school district has come about. And he says, quote, "The Southmoreland School District is truly a gem within the community that the community members should be proud of," end quote. And of course, I agree wholeheartedly. And I just wanted to publicly thank the committee for considering Southmoreland as the in education as the theme for this year's Fall Festival. And that ends my report.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Rhodes.
Superintendent's report.
I do have one walk-on item this evening. It's recommended that the board employ Kayla Bricker of Scottsdale, Pennsylvania as a substitute cafeteria and clerical employee.
Need a motion, please?
So
moved. Motion by Mrs. Shipley, second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Calero. Questions from the audience? This is a non-agenda item. Roll call, please.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0.
Obviously, since our last business meeting, the school year started, and we got off to a very smooth start this year. Transportation has been running smoothly. On the first day of school, the last elementary student was home before 5:30 p.m. That sounds pretty late, but for the first week of school, that's really not all that late. It takes a very long time for teachers and aides to make sure students are on the right buses, and then the bus drivers go very slowly to make sure the students get off at the right stop. So at the elementary level, those buses go very slowly. All of this was in spite of the fact that we did have an elementary bus breakdown in the middle of the first day of school transportation. So it was a little bit hot. We had a breakdown, and we still had everybody home by 5:30. So we're quite pleased with that. Very few students missed their buses during the first week of school. The warm weather did present a bit of a challenge for us, especially on the buses and at the primary center. But the classrooms in the primary center now have window air conditioning units. That helps to alleviate some of the heat, and it also pulls some of the moisture out of the air. So it was not as bad as it has been in some years, but it was still pretty warm in that building. But students fared well, and we were certainly glad for a break in the weather today. Just on a side note, the McKinney-Vento Act delineates definitions for homeless students, and there are a number of ways students can be homeless. You can be homeless by not having a regular place to sleep at night. So you might be in a car, you might be in a camper, in an RV park, or you might be sleeping on a couch somewhere, or you might be doubled up with a family member. So if a family loses their home and they're doubled up and moved back in with grandma and grandpa, for example, that family's also considered homeless. So there are a number of ways students become homeless. And Southmoreland started this year with 24 students who are categorized as homeless through the McKinney-Vento Act. That may be one of the higher numbers that we've seen in recent years. Part of it is we're doing a better job of identifying, and part of it is I think we have more people who are doubling up, and a lot of these kids are doubled up and living with grandparents due to either broken families or inability to pay rent or any number of reasons, but 24 throughout the district this year. Football, boys, girls soccer, boys and girls golf, girls tennis, cross country, volleyball, those are all underway for the fall season. So I would encourage you, if you have an opportunity, to get out and watch our kids play and support them. I know they work very hard at their individual sports, and they do appreciate it when teachers, administrators, and board members come to watch them. So any of those events that you can make it to would certainly be appreciated. We were recently monitored by the Pennsylvania Department of Education Division of Federal Programs. And I put a note in your packet last year, but we were found to be in total compliance with absolutely no corrective action necessary. Federal Programs is laden with rules, regulations, and we were able this time to have a fully clean audit, so we're quite pleased with that. And along the same lines, we got a letter this week learning that Southmoreland has again met all the requirements to be in total compliance with Part B of the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, or IDEA, as you might hear it called. That determination was based on the fact that we performed satisfactorily on the components of the state performance plan. We submitted information to PDE in a timely manner, as they asked for it. And there are a lot of special education reports that go into PDE, believe me. Any areas of non-compliance during our monitoring were corrected within 1 year of notification. And on a fiscal note, Part B funds were expended in accordance with all the fiscal requirements. So two of our major programs, federal programs and special education, which have a lot of rules attached to them, were in compliance, so we were quite pleased. We had no corrective actions there. The school performance profile, we talked a lot about that last year. We found out yesterday that the governor has placed a one-year pause on school performance profiles for buildings that administer the PSSA. Buildings that administer the Keystone exams will still have a school performance profile score. And as that information comes and as we our test results continue to trickle in, I'm hoping to have a full report on state of the schools and school performance profiles and those kinds of things for you next month. So I'll be able to provide more details for you as we move forward there. And finally, the gymnasium floor is completed and the high school entry project is substantially completed with only a few minor punch list items to be finished. Some of you had an opportunity to look at that this evening. Punch list items on the entry are mostly cosmetic. The paint that the contractor used didn't quite match what we already had, so we're asking that to be redone, and just a couple other little cosmetic things we'd like to have done so that the job is done absolutely correctly. We're hoping, or not hoping, we know that that system will provide a safer environment for our students. It will provide many less people who are in the office where sometimes confidential conversations are going on. That those individuals won't be in the office anymore, but will rather wait in the vestibule where they can drop things off for their student, pick their student up for an early dismissal, things of that nature. And it also controls ingress and egress, mostly ingress to the high school building, so that unwanted individuals may not come in there. Are we going to keep everybody out that has nefarious motives? No. Are we possibly going to keep someone out who may be a non-custodial parent who might do harm or take one of our kids when they shouldn't? Yes. So we think it was money well spent. Samantha, what do you think of the new entry system? I'm going to put you on the spot.
It's functioned really well so far, and it looks great.
Okay. Thank you. That concludes my report, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Calera.
The arrival times for the elementary, you said it's 5:30, which was good for the first week. What are the normal, when we get into the school year, what normally time do they normally get home?
Normally our last student is home 4:30, 20 to 5.
Okay.
The last bus usually leaves around 4 o'clock, maybe a little bit after.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. President. I was recipient of emails from Dr. Lamar and Mr. Marnell concerning some issues affecting or potentially affecting the school district because of the state budget impasse. Southmoreland passed its budget. As just mentioned, the state still hasn't passed its budget. And bills are coming due for specific kinds of obligations that are different from our usual creditors, beyond payroll per se and supplies. The first problem is that there will be a quarterly payment due for the quarter ending on June 30th of 2015 for what is called the employer's share of the contribution to the public school employees retirement system. The acronym for that is PESRS. And the issue here is whether the school district, for as long as it has 2015-2016 budgeted and received revenues and budgeted unassigned fund balance funds available, is legally obligated in the absence of a state budget to remit payment to PESRS for A, the net employer share, or B, the entire employer share, or C, none of the employer share. My opinion is, my professional legal opinion is that the answer is A, the net employer share. And that's based upon a reading of different sections of the public school employees retirement system statute, and in particular section 8535(3) and another section. I believe that the clause, quote, school entity shall have up to 5 days after receipt of the Commonwealth's portion of the employer's liability to make payment to the public school employees retirement fund, refers only to a delay for receipt of the Commonwealth's share and not to the local school entity's employer's share. I've given a written opinion. I'm not going to read it, but the concept here is that, as Mr. Marnell had mentioned at times in the past, at least to me several times, I'm not sure if he told you, but he's told me several times, that up until June 30th, 1995, under the old system, the local school entities would send in 50% of the contribution rate for their employees, and the Commonwealth would send its 50% directly to PESRS. The statute was changed And in changing it, the initial or primary obligation was put on the school district to make the payment and is in fact the quote employer, close quote. As a matter of timing, in normal circumstances, money would come, after there's a state budget, money would come to the school district, and pursuant to another statute, the school district has 5 days to send payment in to PEASERS. The question is, if the due date comes up and you haven't yet received the money from the state, what are you to do? Do you send only your portion? Do you send in the complete payment even though you haven't yet collected it from the state? Or do you send nothing in? There was one opinion that I believe took an extreme of a position that based upon that one section, that the school districts didn't have to send in any payment. I don't think that that is consistent with looking at all sections of the statute, and would be contrary to certain rules of construction, which courts look at in situations when questions are brought up about interpreting state statutes. Because of the existence of the previous statute and the changeover to making the school entities the employer initially liable for the contribution, I think that the plain reading of that exception is to limit it to not having to send in the state share if you haven't received it. If we didn't send in our share, or for that matter, any other school district didn't do it, you would have the benefit of being able to perhaps earn some income on it, which isn't a bad thing per se, but sort of acts as a windfall because in normal circumstances, you would be expected to be sending that in. And at the same time, deprives the already underfunded PEASERS pension retirement fund of the ability to be investing those funds and making money to pay defined pension benefits to our own retirees and retirees, for that matter, that are all over the state, which I think would be an unreasonable result, and the legislature does not intend for unreasonable results whenever it passes statutes. So although legally you could send in the entire payment, I don't think that makes sense either, because you have the benefit of that exception. You haven't received the state money yet. So I think the correct answer in the choices are A, to send in the net employer share. Just to add some more information, just last Thursday, late afternoon, PEASERS sent out a memo to all of the school districts saying that they strongly disagreed with the opinion of the solicitor for PSBA, who was arguing that we didn't have to send in any share, and that based upon past precedent, they thought the correct answer was to send in only our share. And if that didn't happen, there was a threat of being charged 6% interest. 6% is a lot of interest to have to pay out whenever school districts and other investors have no way of making 6% on reasonably safe investments. In order to give guidance to the business officer office and the treasurer, I prepared a resolution, and I'm recommending that you choose option A, the net employer share, as to be the amount that should be sent in. But I'm limiting this for a period of time to see what happens. as long as budgeted funds are still available. And that will start to become a problem in the fall, and the entire matter of paying bills may become a matter of further discussion and board decision. At this point, I agree that the proper thing to do is to give the school board the opportunity to make the decision, because ultimately the school board passes budgets and has to raise taxes and has to make cuts and that sort of thing. So rather than leaving it to just for the business officer to try to figure out what to do, you have the opportunity to vote on it. Questions?
Let's get a motion and a second on the floor. No question. You have a motion?
And what he's recommended, just send or share it, right?
Yes.
You're recommending the first one.
Yes.
The first. Before you vote on anything, I need to know what we're making.
Yes. Okay. There are two resolutions. The first resolution deals with PEASRs.
Okay.
On the resolution itself, it is worded for, and it's the front page, to send in only the net employer share. The three choices are mentioned in the memo.
Right.
Yes.
I didn't put all three choices on the resolution.
Okay, I see. Okay.
So, motion by Mrs. Rhodes, you have a second. Mrs. Shipley. Any more questions or comments?
A couple questions, David. 6% that's paid, is it paid to the state or does it go into PEASRs? If we were fine, it goes to PEASRs.
That's what they're claiming.
Yeah.
So the state.
I'm not saying that that's necessarily, you know, the last word on that. I'm just saying that they're making that claim.
Okay, I just wanted to be sure that again, the state wasn't saying that if we didn't send it to PEASRs, they were going to get 6% of that as a penalty for us failing. It's going to PEASRs.
It's a pension fund.
Okay, that's fine. Second question, and granted, I know we don't make our decisions based on what everybody else does, but I am curious, as a solicitor and other solicitors and other school districts, have you at all discussed this as what other districts are going to do? Because based on what you're saying here, is that right now, because we have the money, we should pay it. When we may not have the money, we'll not be paying it. It's still going to be the same penalty. The state isn't going to say, well, you didn't have the money, so you couldn't pay it.
There will be no penalty on not making the state's share.
No, I know that. Right. The penalty only be on our share.
If we don't make our share.
Right, but what I'm saying is David said that if we pay, since we have the money now, we should pay our share. That's his recommendation. But he's also saying that based on how long this budget impasse goes on, we may not have the money, so later on we wouldn't be able to pay it, or we'd have to do something else to try to come money. And at that point, we would be just as liable as we are right now for that 6%. So the difference is only we've got to pay it, we may not have it later, and we won't be able to pay it.
It's the quarterly payment for
right.
The
I realize
quarter ending June 3rd.
Right, I understand what we're doing. I'm just saying that you're making this payment because we have the money now.
And Mr. Clare, to clarify, and Mr. Tonic isn't maybe aware of this, but Mr. Mornell and I have talked. We are recommending that we can make the payment because that is our obligation. And if this impasse were to go on to the extent of time where we don't feel that we would have money to meet our obligations, we would be coming to the board again and talking about a revenue anticipation note to provide us with the operating funds to continue to meet our obligations, one of which would be the employer share of PEASRs. Mount Pleasant has already done this. I believe several other districts in the county have already done it. Our fund balance is such that we don't anticipate a need to do that for a while yet, but we would meet those obligations, yes.
So that kind of answers my other question. So some of the school districts around are taking out a loan to avoid having to pay the 6% interest by not paying their share of the PEASRs.
They're borrowing money to meet payroll.
Right.
And, yeah,
well, but being payroll is one thing, but right, but all obligations.
All, yes, yeah. Right. In other words, that they wish to remain solvent and to take care of their obligations, and then that loan would be repaid once our subsidies come through.
But we would meet all our obligations except for PEASRs if we decided not to accept this resolution. We would still pay all payroll. It's just that the amount for funds for PEASRs would not go in. We're not taking...
The state share of PEASRs would not go in.
I know. I'm saying if we don't accept this, if we say that we will not pay our share of PESRs, we would still be meeting all our other obligations to the state as far as payroll goes.
Yes.
And so what you're telling me is all the other school districts right now, some of them are taking out an anticipation loan, not just to meet PESRs, but also to meet their payroll obligations, or are they just doing it to take out?
No, to meet general operating expenses.
Right. So they're, again, so we're only, the only thing we're looking at here is we need to know if we want to pay our obligation, our individual school district obligation for PESRs. Everything else we would be paying.
Well, I think what you're really deciding is that you don't want to pay the state share of PESRs.
No.
No,
that's not what I'm thinking. That's not what I hear here. This resolution is saying that we are willing to pay the net, which is would be just our share. Or we could also vote not to pay anything, which would be not the state share that they would give us that we would then turn over to PESRs, or our share of PESRs. But you're recommending that
you could vote to pay our share and the state share, which makes no sense.
Right, and I'm not even suggesting that. I'm just saying that the choice here is between either paying PESRs our share or telling PESRs they're not getting anything from our share.
Well,
but we would still meet all other obligations to the state.
I'm not even putting on the table.
Yeah, if this resolution were to fail, then we would
I'd ask you to vote to say what you want to do, not just that it fails, but I mean, so that it's clear to the business office. But the other thing I wanted to say, to be crystal clear about this, is that I didn't even present an option of not turning over the monies that have already been withheld from employees, which is the employee share. So that's not school district money. That's the, you know, employees, of which the school district is really acting in a fiduciary capacity,
right,
and going to pass that on.
You remit that monthly.
And that's actually remitted under a different schedule.
Yes.
So that's not even up for discussion. The discussion is the, quote, employer share. And I think some of the practical consequences of this are that there is a statute that says we don't have to say pay the state share. I don't think it's reasonable to interpret that statute to say that it means that we don't have to pay our share. I think that that's a leap too far. Additionally, you run the risk of having to pay interest at a much higher rate than what you could possibly make by keeping the money and putting it into Pliget, or for that matter, anywhere else that would be a state-approved investment. So even from a financial perspective, I don't see that that's a, I mean, it's your choice, but it seems like that's not a good risk to take. And that I should at least point it out to you. And then the final thing is that not paying, if everybody in the state were to do that, compounds an already bad problem for the state employees' retirement system, which in turn will only generate, you know, some other kind of
more
taxation or requirements on local school districts to come up with the money. So it's kind of taking a snowball and starting to roll it down the hill and making it worse. But you're all entitled to your own opinions. And so this is, you have the choice, you have my recommendation, and I stand by it.
These are new waters that we're sailing through. Commonwealth public school system have not been faced with this type of crisis. So it worked great in the old days. We paid our share to the retirement board, Commonwealth paid their share. They changed the rules 20 years ago where we make the total payment only after we receive the state's share. So you have a 5-day turnaround to make the total payment. So I agree. Feel our obligation. Retirement board is fine with the school systems waiting until the state budget impasse is settled and the Commonwealth starts remitting over the subsidies for the retirements.
Mr. Molnar, do you anticipate that if the budget impasse goes further, that the next payment due, that we will have the funds available? I think Dr. Molnar said that he believed that we'd have enough in the general fund to cover that. So it would not be an issue of us taking an anticipated...
It would not be an issue for us in December when the next quarterly payment is due, which would be based on July, August, and September, for us to make our share.
Okay.
Any more questions or comments? Since it's a non-agenda item, any questions from the audience? Roll call, please.
Mr. Polakoff?
Did we make a motion?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mrs. Rhodes made the motion. Mrs. Shipley second.
Okay.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Bentz?
Yes. Motion passes 9-0.
The next subject is dealing with smaller amounts of money, but no less vexatious, and that is that the state, the system for paying charter schools is that a calculation is made of what school districts' expenditures were for the previous year. And after certain adjustments and deductions for things like student transportation and bond payments and certain other areas, the money is then divided by your average daily membership or ADMs. And then that becomes the tuition rate to send to a charter school, regardless of what their costs are, whether they're greater than that or lesser than that. And right now, the situation is that school districts are getting billed for tuition by charter schools. However, school districts have not yet received, there is no state budget, so you don't know for sure what the state is going to allocate in the way of your subsidies. And you haven't received any state monies other than the so-called gambling monies, which really are a replacement for your own tax revenues that you subtract from homeowners' taxpayers' bills. You don't subtract the tax, but you subtract the assessment. So after the math is done, it has the same effect. And this question is not quite as clear. But nonetheless, I still feel that in this situation that you are justified in not paying the portion of the tuition that would come from state subsidies and only pay based upon a percentage of what your local revenues bear in proportion to your total budget. And the consequence of that would be that the charter schools would bear the same financial pain that the regular local school districts are experiencing. Although that is not necessarily a reason for doing it. There is a concern that because of this unusual formula, unlike other creditors whom you agree to pay an hourly rate or some kind of a fixed fee, or you have put out bids to buy school supplies, and you determine prices that way. Here, the state is mandating school districts to fund this alternate universe of charter schools, and using as the funding formula your own expenditures from a previous year, and then telling you, even though you don't know what you're going to receive this year, just keep spending at that rate. Now, although you have in effect already budgeted to spend what you perceive to be the portion that you're raising from your own revenues, you still don't know what you're going to get from the state. And under the school code, provides that the total amount of the district budget shall not exceed the amount of funds, including state appropriation, available for school purposes. So without knowing your district's appropriation, you would be paying the full amount of the tuition, means that the district is passing through to the charter schools state subsidies, which you neither know yet nor have received, which appears to be illogical and potentially creates the problem for you of having to reopen your budget, which you may have to also do, and I admit this, you may have to do that for other purposes also. But here, because this kind of creditor is forced upon you, unlike you having the ability to go out and solicit bids for supplies or choose which private entity you want to utilize for special education services, you don't have any choice. You have to do it. And you're given a formula that, in effect, is forcing you to operate on a fiction. So I believe that you have the ability, and there is no mention in the charter school law, and I haven't been recipient yet of any diktats from Harrisburg, of any kind of penalty that could be put on you if you don't pay the full amount, other than it would ultimately be deducted from your state subsidy when there is a budget and when it's appropriated. So the risk is that you will have your subsidy reduced by the amount that you'd ultimately have to pay anyway. And so for those reasons, I think at least you have the discretion to vote to limit the payments to what your local effort is, and not also give state subsidies that you haven't yet received.
So do we have a motion?
So moved.
Motion by Mrs. Shipley, second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Polakowski. And just so we're all on the same page, the motion is to just pay the local clerk.
It's as long as Southmoreland School District fiscal year 2015-2016 budgeted received revenues and budgeted unassigned fund balances are available to pay to charter schools in normal course on or before normal due dates, the school district's tuition for charter schools based upon the total tuition due times a percentage equal to the amount of the 2015-16 budgeted local revenues divided by budgeted total revenues, thus leaving unpaid the amount of tuition corresponding to the percentage of total revenues from state subsidy sources and federal pass-throughs, recognizing that these amounts may be collected by state subsidy intercepts of payments to the school district when there is a state budget. And I think Mr. Marnell may have done a rough calculation of what that number is.
41%. For every $1,000 bill in charter school tuition, we pay $400. And I think the charter schools know and are expecting this. at some point when the budget gets passed, we'll start getting our subsidies and we can pay our accounts off.
Any more questions or comments? Questions from the audience? Roll call, please.
Mrs. Rhodes?
Yes.
Mrs. Shipley?
Yes.
Mr. Ault?
Yes.
Mr. Beistel?
Yes.
Mr. Calero?
Yes.
Mr. Frye?
Yes.
Mrs. Love?
Yes.
Mr. Polakowski?
Yes.
Mr. Vance?
Yes, motion passes 9 to 0.
That concludes my report.
Thank you. Citizens' comments? No. Any motion to adjourn? I'm sorry, any board members have anything? Motion to adjourn? Motion by Mrs. Rhodes, second.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Shipley. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Good night. Safe driving.
Thanks, everyone.